As Jean-Louis told you yesterday, our friend Zikin held a series of conference on zeta functions, and also summer schools he had in Yaroslavl and other places. Then he was professor in Polynesia, and during diving he disappeared, and to his memory I would like to contribute. Also, he put all summer schools on web, so you could find my lectures, for example, in this file, which is also available from the site of this conference, and the lectures in Yaroslavl, which are about modular forms and periodical functions also. You see, Alexei Zikin liked very much this region, and together with Siegfried Boehlert, we climbed to the mountain Shamshod on the 22nd of June 2012. So this picture represents, you see, with Siegfried and me, we were on the top, so he's looking maybe on Mont Blanc, also to the direction where we are here. So it's, I thought it would be appropriate to use. He was very sportive, you see, and did dive into 660 meters. And it was, unfortunately, this. But this is a risk, you see. He was risky. So my mini course will contain four lectures. I start with classical groups, because they are major source of L functions and zeta functions. So we will explain it together with Siegfried. But first I will explain about what is a classical group, and so to say, symplectic group, JLN, and which is the link of modular forms and these groups, functions on the groups. The second lecture is about classical and Hermitian modular forms, so it's some particular Hermitian group and GL2. And automorphic complex L functions will be discussed together with the Rankine-Selberg method, which is important in various fields. So, but the origin of construction of L functions is a Hecke algebra, so we'll use it throughout. I will define today also Hecke algebras. Third lecture is completely periodic. It will be about Kummer congruences and the theory of periodic integration, which is goes in parallel with the theory of Euler products. Because in the periodic theory, you don't have Euler products, but instead you have a theory of periodic measures, which I will explain in third lecture. And in the fourth lecture, we'll construct a new kind of periodic L functions of Hermitian type. And I will also clarify motivic sense, because motifs are also in the title of our conference. Yeah? Motifs which come up there have some Hodge numbers equal to 2, not only equal to 1, like in Michael Harris calls it regular motifs, with Hodge numbers equal to 1 or 0. Here we'll have also Hodge numbers equal to 2. And I will explain and use also Newton polygon and Hodge polygon in this theory. So what I will do is a theory of admissible measures, and will construct periodic L functions. That I also discussed in Durham recently, so I'm very glad to, Yolanda is here, so she heard it already, and I heard your lecture. So here you have also a French version of my talk, but it's not necessary. So first lecture is about classical groups, the case of JLN. So why we discuss this general topic? This is not precisely our, how to say, basic task. But I would like to explain you what is important, that the most basic zeta function is the Riemann zeta function, which is an Euler product. It's of course a series, but also an Euler product over primes of 1 minus p to the minus s to the minus 1 converges for real s bigger than 1. So this is also the case for the Dirichlet L series S chi, where chi is a character modulo n to the p to the n in our theory. So we'll fix some prime number and consider characters of growing conductor. But somehow the variable s and the variable chi here, they are parts of the same variable. Adelically, it's a part of the same. So I will not separate them much. And here you also can see that 1 minus p to the minus s is the inverse polynomial, 1 minus x to the minus 1. And this gives a hint how to extend the definition of L functions to other more general cases. So using the classical groups also, that I will explain now. So it's a general situation. We have a L function which will be attached to some representation theoretic data. So I'll explain what is it. And it has a form of the Euler product in which factors are characteristic polynomials. Sorry, I write it fp to the p minus s to the minus 1, where fp actually depends on the data. This is a characteristic polynomial of some matrix I minus x times m p and p, so-called Satake matrix. So this is a polynomial which is a unitary. Fp of 0 is 1. And his degree will be less equal than d. In the case of Riemann zeta, d is equal to 1, the degree of the zeta function. Yeah. So this is definition of such matrices, Satake matrices, we'll also discuss. So it is possible to do for quite general objects. And also, what we need that the polynomial here has coefficients in q bar, so it will be algebraic. So fp of x, another property, it belongs to q bar of x. And q bar is embedded to the complex number. So this will be our, embedding fixed once for all. We'll also fix it embedded to the periodic number Cp, which is completion of the algebraic closure of Qp, periodic field. So it will be I infinity and this will be Ip. So it will be fixed throughout our, but I will not need it today. Periodic numbers we study from the third lectures. So for me, so I start my lecture basically by recalling some things which you might have been seen, but I like this very much, the text which I use throughout. It's Borel's lectures for the summer school also. So you see there were famous summer schools in mathematics in Boulder. There was a famous summer school in 1966. Where Borel did some magnificent. So it was a basis of the modern theory of algebraic groups and representations. And then there was another summer school, which is very famous, in Corvallis, in state of Oregon. That was in 77. So 11 years after, no, 12 years after. So Then another one in which I participated was in Seattle in 91. It was a summer school on motifs and also on automorphical functions. There was a link described there in detail. And then also in Grenoble, we organized many summer schools. And which were, one is necessary to mention also, in Lumini. There was a famous summer school for Sears conjectures, the proof of Sears conjectures in 2007, to which also I participated. There was 150 people, you see. And most famous mathematicians took part, like Sears, for example, and Tate, of course. Tate and Sear and Mazur, many people were there. But in Grenoble, we also had the summer school. When I just arrived, my first duty was to organize this arithmetic geometry. And also, in this time, it was when proof of Fermat's theorem appeared, you see. And Professor Manin was on a visit in Marseille, and then he passed through Grenoble and gave in this summer school a brilliant lecture about the mirror symmetry. And then it stimulated much the final proof of this Manin's lecture. Professor Manin was my supervisor, so it was a very happy occasion to meet him in Grenoble when I just started in 93. It was the first summer school. Then we had also summer school on cryptology, yeah? And you organized many summer schools, yeah, on dynamical systems, yeah? And, but I think this is a very good idea to have a summer school here, because it's a very appropriate, very nice place. I like very much. It's close to many things and to the lake, first of all. Then after school, after lectures, you could go to swim. It's very good, you see, very refreshing. So I strongly advise you. But let us now pass to mathematical. So in these lectures, I would like to open you this file of Borel's lectures. But how to, yeah, sorry. I need, right. There is no, you use a mouse, yeah? I see, open file, yeah. This is Borel's lectures. And how to do full screen? Control L, maybe, yeah? Control L. No. Full screen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay.
Okay, and full screen.
Okay. So this is the lectures of Borel in the school of Boulder in 66. Boulder, it's a Colorado, state of Colorado. That was the first very important. Of course, in Japan, there was famous summer school in 55, where this was a Shimura Taniyama conjecture was originated and Weyl gave there. But that was much time ago. But now how to, sorry, I should use to this, to remove. Escape, yeah, escape. Yeah, escape and, here, yeah? Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. So I will discuss some, recall you some definitions and basic properties from these lectures of Borel, because you can read it yourself. Of course, this may be your favorite reading. So I do not need much. Only I develop some points which will be important in the future. And then we'll discuss such things like parabolic subgroups, radical reductive groups, and the semisimple groups also. And the structure theorem I will only describe also with so and then I will pass to our book with Professor Manin, where we described link between automorphic forms and the Langlands program. That was the part of the chapter six. Yes. And then also important here to describe the link between classical modular forms and representation theory, which are related closely. So it's so now let me just maybe I omit this. I skip some parts because you all know maybe such things. Algebraic group is called irreducible if it is connected, so to say, connected group, and in the sense of Zariski topology, of course, yeah. The connected component of the identity will be called G0, and the index G0 in G is finite. So it is some properties. Then definition comes, algebraic group over a field K, then the radical of G is defined as the greatest connected normal subgroup of G, and the unipotent radical is the greatest connected unipotent normal subgroup. These are elements represented by unipotent matrices, and the group is semi-simple if the radical is one, and it is, pardon, is a semi-simple if radical is equal to one, and it is reductive if is unipotent radical is equal to one. Here is example I give also, of course, JLN and SLN, they are respectively semi-simple and reductive. Yeah. So, but this is just example which we use throughout, and then that is the definitions. You could read up that they make sense and check their properties. But now we pass to structure theorems. If G is algebraic subgroup, there are two conditions are equivalent. G connected component is reductive if and only if G0 is a reductive, is a product of central torus and G prime, where G prime is semi-simple group. So central torus, do not confuse with maximal torus. It's a just central torus in the center of the group. So you can extract it somehow and represent it as a product. This is a in Borel's text, just a quote. This is all quotation from Borel's. Then this is the next theorem is about connected, is about maximal tori. So it's not central tori. This is a maximal tori. Torus is a product of GL1 of algebraic closed field torus. It could be defined also of a smaller field, could be non-split, but all maximal tori are conjugate, so it every semi-simple element is contained in a torus. This is a property, semi-simple diagonalizable in some representation. So centralizer of any subtorus is connected. The second property, maximal, all maximal connected solvable subgroups are conjugate. This is kind of triangular subgroup. Yeah, triangular subgroup is a maximal connected solvable subgroup. Yeah, so it's and its torus called it's called Borel subgroup also, and its torus is defined. So third, if P is a closed subgroup, then it is called parabolic subgroup if the space G over P is a projective variety. Yeah. typical parabolic subgroup corresponds to Grassmannians, the fault of Grassmannian variety. And of course, the Borel subgroup is a parabolic subgroup. So it is just example. Now I recall some also characters and roots which are used for the classification of character is a representation. That means it's algebraic homomorphism from G to GL1 of a group. So mainly one considers characters of maximal torus, which are used in the classification. So when we have a representation, we restrict it to a parabolic subgroup and to its maximal torus. And then we have characters. Characters will be very important for the L functions. So the group of characters G hat, it is denoted, is always finitely generated. If you have a torus, the group of characters of a torus is a Z lattice. So it, and also there is a product, because you see all characters from GL1 to GL1 form a group Z isomorphic to Z. So you can, for two characters, you can take a product and consider is as a natural number, which is as an integer. This integer give you a scalar product in the characters of a torus, for example. That will need. Algebraic, only algebraic group. This all groups are here algebraic, yeah. Yeah. So it is, I follow Borel's. So the notation, which is very often used, is chi of G as a value of a character on a group, but also G to the K. This exponential notation is very useful because the group of characters is abelian in this case. So you can use addition of characters as an additive group in this case. So it's very useful. And also maybe I omit things related to Lie groups because Lie algebras is an object which is always used, especially for differential operators, yes. But for me, I consider only the following remark. If you have a Lie group, subgroup of GLN, yeah, embedded to GLN, then you can define also a Lie algebra of it. It is sent as set of matrices such that matrix 1 plus epsilon x belongs to the set of points of the group over the double numbers k of epsilon. Here k is a field and k of epsilon is a double numbers. Epsilon square is equal to 0. So these are just two numbers, double numbers. And so to define the Lie algebra of an algebraic group, it's very simple. You could just write its elements as such matrices X with this property that 1 plus epsilon X satisfies the definition of the algebraic group. And we'll do some examples, of course, for the symplectic groups. But for the group GLN, it's Lie algebra, it's just group of all matrices. And you check also by this definition that for SLN, the Lie algebra is a set of matrices without trace, with a trace equal to 0. So it's the first examples of Lie algebras. Of course, there is operation also, bracket, but I will not discuss it. Maybe Siegfried will need it. It's like a hint. Yeah. But also, you see, here I mentioned the field, okay? It could be a field of rational numbers, or a field of complex numbers, or real numbers. We have different theories for such. But also I will use some algebraic number field, K over Q, less of them of finite dimension. Then we have also set of points and completions, K lambda, all completions. So this is a more general setting. And we can define the L function also over this field K as a some other Euler product, but here maybe dependence on K is important. So P index K maybe, all right? This is a product of over all prime ideals or maximal ideals in the field of, in the ring of numbers of K. And here we have polynomials F indexed by these maximal ideals to the norm P to the minus S to the minus one. So this is Euler product which is used for the number fields. And FP of X is also characteristic polynomial of some matrix. FP of X is a determinant of 1 minus, no, sorry, ID minus X times Sataki matrix M, which is attached to a prime place P and the pi. Pi and prime place P. We'll meet such construction in the last chapter when using Hermitian modular forms over, how to say. So, but what is it, sorry. Sorry, how to start again? I should be careful next time. But I take maybe. Okay, thank you very much. So this is the terminology of the Lie algebras. There is also exponential mapping from Lie algebra to Lie group, algebraically defined, but I will not use it. Only maybe last thing that also from Borel's lectures, that Jordan decomposition for any matrix of a field, here is denoted by omega in Borel's lectures, can be written uniquely as a product of GS and GN. Maybe GU here. So the unipotent matrix and semisimple matrix. Sorry. So let me also recall in more detail some example related to Borel subgroup, because it uses geometric language. So we fix matrix description of GLN using a basis of some vector space V of dimension n. And we consider flag, which is a sequence of subspaces. And di will be the dimension of vi. So, and the sequence of these numbers describes the type of the flag. So for the maximal flag, it's 1, 2, 3, up to d minus 1, n minus 1, yeah. Maximal flag. So a parabolic subgroup of GLN is the stability group of a flag, F, ou drapeau en français, in the vector space omega. Here omega is a ground field. And the G of over P is a manifold of flags of the same type. So it's a Grassmannian variety. It is known to be also projective. So this is typical example. And Borel subgroup is the stability group of a full flag. In a suitable basis, it is a group of all upper triangular matrices. This is just all recalling. But what is it? No. But how to come back? Alt? No. No. Because I put to the last page. It was a different. Sorry. Where I was? Here. Yeah. So also orthogonal group. We consider orthogonal group related to some symmetric product. So here, f of, maybe I write in this way. We consider some vector space with a symmetric bilinear form. And then you have a quadratic form which attached to this. Quadratic form f is given by the value of a symmetric so bilinear form on the space V over K. And this gives you also the group, which is called orthogonal groups. These are all endomorphisms which leave this, which fix this quadratic form. And you can also put it to the canonical form some. You have some, how to say, this is a standard form where F0, it doesn't represent zero rationally. It is an anisotropic part. And thus, these are hyperbolic parts, yeah, hyperbolic spaces. So it's just the general form of quadratic forms. Here we also consider the characteristic as different from two. Yeah. The few, or it is zero, maybe even. But what is in this case a torus, maximal torus? In the JLN case, it is a set of all diagonal matrices. In this case, this is the following set of matrices. You have diagonal elements up to Q, where Q is a this part, and then you have symmetric terms to with the minus one and ones for the anisotropic part. So this is a structure of the maximal torus, which we'll need also in the sequel. So the unitary group now comes. It is also can be described with a cisquilinear form, but I just give you elementary definition of a unitary group of type NM. Yeah, it is, if you have such a matrix, so you have a Hermitian pairing given by this matrix on a vector space over E, where E is some imaginary quadratic imaginary subfield for, I'm annoyed by this. So next time I'll be more careful. So and the unitary group also, you can define the unitary group in the following way. As algebraic group with points given by non-degenerate, so automorphisms of the module OE, this is times R for any algebra over E over OE, and which satisfies the following condition. It preserves the Hermitian pairing, yeah, related to this Hermitian form. And now all classical groups which we'll study will be can be given in this setting, including also symplectic group and Hermitian groups. It was given in the very beautiful book of Dieudonné. You could find also in Garrett's web page direct. That's how to move it. Sorry. Because I want to move a little. Ah, okay. So, I gave courses on this, and JLN, so we'll now describe geometrically classical groups using bilinear Hermitian forms. And subgroups can be also described using Witt theorem, but that I do not insist, maybe. You can read it yourself. But it is in the file, so. So concerning matrix notation, we'll use always matrices AIG, and also action of the involution and some complex conjugation, for example. In this notation. In geometric study of the subgroups of JLN, it is based on the theory of this flux, approach. But in the matrix coordinates, so we use, of course, independent of matrix approach, but matrix illustration is the following. Look. But how to move it? Sorry, because I cannot, because this will... Which one? This? Because I'm afraid now to go to the end of the file. This one, yeah? This? Okay, thank you. Well, that one is dangerous. Okay. So these are block matrices, you see, with zeros below the diagonal and the arbitrary element above the diagonal. So it's a typical parabolic subgroup of the type D1, D2, and so on, D and minus 1. D, not n minus 1, but n minus dm, where the m. Now you can define also Levi component conjugation. Yeah, also look. If you take a supplementary flag, which is formed of complements of each elements of the flag, but in other sense, you obtain another parabolic subgroup, which is called opposite, yeah? And its intersection is the Levi component of this. It is formed by the block matrices with zeros outside the diagonal blocks. So please, this is a... Its structure is a product of standard semi-direct, complementary Levi component. Yeah, so P is equal to the product of M and the unipotent radical of P. So it's a, because it is both contained in one and in other. So it's just also definitions. And now one of the important theorems comes that all the parabolic subgroups of given type are conjugate in GLK of N. And all the Levi components of parabolic group are conjugated by elements of P inside the parabolic subgroup. And all the maximal K-split tori are also conjugated in GLK of V. So I do not prove it because it's a part of standard courses, which are very popular also in the university course. But what is important that all this construction can be extended to modulus of a skew field, which is non-commutative, but a kind of division field, division algebra, division ring, which will be denoted by D. Without coordinates, we define a vector space of finite dimension of a skew division ring as a finitely generated left or right module. So we fix. Mostly will be left module, because then its dual is right module. So it's here is one needs attention if D is not commutative. And so let me maybe omit all these materials about the ring of endomorphisms, which is a end D of V, and which can be described also by matrices with coefficients in D. But there are some fine points which I do not discuss also. And the theory of flags, also one can define the flags as sequences of D submodules and define the parabolic subgroups and so on. And there is a similar theorem valid that. And now let me pass to the bilinear, skilinear, and Hermitian forms of a general such a field. This is a. So the classical groups are usually defined as groups of isometries of the vector space of a commutative or non-commutative object endowed with some form, symmetric form, Sesquilinear form, or Hermitian form. So it's a bilinear, Sesquilinear. I'll not define it also. It's also part. But let me just write down maybe the formal definition here. So set of G from GLK of V such that the product is preserved. So this is a bilinear form in the orthogonal case. But we can treat also the symplectic groups in the same way, what I like very much. Symplectic group is a group attached to such a bilinear form, which is anti-symmetric, so to say. Alternative GV1, GV2 is a minus. So, and this produces a symplectic group. So, this is a group of all non-degenerate automorphisms which preserve such a form. And this is a group SP. One also can define GSP, which is a semi-simple group, which is a group of symplectic similitudes. This notation is very widely used. So these are endomorphisms which multiply by some factor this form. Also, one can describe them with matrices, such groups. But now I pass to the classification of groups. So this is a separate topic, maybe. One do not need to enter in much detail, but I tell some words because it will be used, terminology will be used. Root system, for example. If you have a finite dimensional real vector space, then there is a nice sorry, I was afraid. So let me write on the table, maybe. So what is a root system? I recall you just the So there are three properties, you see. This is a, it's called by phi. Phi Rn is a root system. If the three following properties are satisfied, phi is finite, of course, phi is finite. And it consists of a finite number of non-zero elements such that symmetry phi is phi is equal to the minus phi. So it's symmetric with respect to the origin, first property. Second property, that for every alpha from phi, the symmetry S alpha with respect to the hyperplane perpendicular to alpha leaves this finite set, takes it to itself. So this S alpha, maybe I write S alpha of beta equals to beta minus 2 times alpha beta. This is a scalar product in the set of roots, to which set of roots become to the alpha, yeah. Then this is an integer also, belong to the z. Usually it is equal to the minus 1 also, this. This integer this is integrality property. But the third property also is very important. Yeah, this is integrality property, okay. And using such a systems, one can classify also the algebraic groups, reductive algebraic groups, using this famous classification theorem, which was first discovered by Killing, maybe. Yeah? Killing, then Cartan, that is a great page of the history of mathematics. But I give you maybe some example of a root system. The most famous one is A2, the root system, which is 2 here is a dimension of the vector space generated by the roots. So it's lambda 1 minus lambda 2 and lambda 2 minus lambda 3. This is called alpha and this is called beta. So this is a root system on the of the group SL3. It corresponds to SL3. So it's but this is a very combinatorial object. It can be classified independently of the link with the algebraic groups. And it was done, of course, it was classified. There are cases which I maybe write down on the table because it's a very beautiful. Here you have on the screen also the root systems corresponding to the, how obtain them? You obtain them from the action on the maximal torus, of the maximal torus on the vector, tangent vector space on the Lie algebra, yeah? So in this action gives you matrices of this type, you see, AN, these are matrices which I wrote down, L1, lambda 1 minus lambda 2, lambda 2 minus lambda 3, and so on. So SL1, the another three, they all belong to the classical groups. BN is SO to N plus 1, then you have CN SP to N, and DN, which is also orthogonal groups. One can also write diagrams which classify them, Dynkin diagrams. You see, he was also my colleague from Moscow when they were. And then you have, instead of this series of classical groups, you have also exceptional groups, exceptional root systems of degree 2 of dimension 2, 4, 6, 7, and 8. So we cannot discuss also. But you will find them in the file, which I would like to demonstrate to you. It is also in the, you can download it in Wikipedia, actually, you can. So, but yeah, how to open, so I take, yeah. No, yeah, full screen, yeah. This one, yeah. You see, using own computer is maybe makes easier, but you do it, yeah. How to do a full screen? Okay, because I usually take Control 2. No, Control L, it gives you full screen. Maybe it works also. So here in this article in the Wikipedia, you find, of course, all the this classification and also pictures. Because, for example, the system, root system A2, which is the most famous one, is the first example also, yeah? It is given here. But let me also, so all these properties are listed here, and there are also the other root systems which are presented, and also Dynkin diagrams. These are, they relate by some basis element of the root systems with angles between the consecutive, so they, but that I omit, maybe, sorry. So I would like to, one thing I need. That please look, what we'll need, the AN. This is a cardinality of this root system, yeah? And the cardinality of the Weyl group. Weyl group is a group which is generated by the reflections of this root system. And we'll need it for the group JLN and symplectic group, and also orthogonal group of odd number of variables. But you can see it for the, for all groups, it is listed in this file. So for A2, this is 6. Yeah, this is for BN, this is 2 to the n, n factorial, cn, this is symplectic case, it corresponds to the symplectic group, the same order, actually these two groups are isomorphic. And for dn, it's a slightly different, it's 2 to the n minus 1, n factorial, yeah. And also for the exceptional groups, you find all the materials, there is also a nice relation to modular forms and theta series, which I not discussed here. Yeah. So, let me continue now. First to, oh, to this, yeah. Quit. Escape away. Very stupid, quit. Ah, here, yeah. Okay. Yeah, like this, yeah. Okay, so properties of the root systems. And now look, how this group, Weyl group, acts in the case of JLN. Look, here we have the maximal torus formed by diagonal matrices. And we can write it in the form. S is a matrix of the torus, and its first element, Sii, or ith elements, we call S to the lambda I. So it gives you some character of the torus. And these vectors, they are in the space Rn here. And for the group JLN, And the action on the Lie algebra gives you the following known formula. So it's the notation here which we used, it's s to the lambda I divided by the s to the lambda j. So it can be written also s to the lambda I minus lambda j. So all these elements, lambda I minus lambda j, so they form this root system. It's the all root system, and you have it demonstrated by the case. So in this case, for GLN, the Weyl group is of order n minus 1 factorial, yeah? For GLN, yeah, because it's you take differences, yeah, and then. And now for the symplectic group, what we'll have? We can have also describe it also with matrices. Here you have a matrix Jn, which is 0, minus 1, minus identity matrix, identity 0. And the elements of this group of points of symplectic group of symplectic similitudes characterized are the block matrices, which are characterized by the conditions that they leave this form multiplied by nu of gamma. And if you write it with matrices, you obtain the following description. These elements, how to say, commute up to this operation, BA transpose equal to ATB. And the D A transposed minus C B transposed equal to the 1. And the inverse matrices also can be written in block form. So it's very similar what we have in for GLN, but we work with blocks. So it makes this theory of symplectic group very, how to say, nice, because you can operate with blocks in many cases, like with the numbers. And also the multiplier here. Yes. Define the homomorphism from GA to A plus A star. And the determinant of matrix in square is a power of this multiplier. And the kernel of this multiplier is denoted by SP. This is a symplectic group, which is a reductive, but GSPN is only semi-simple. Yeah? So the maximal torus also is written as block matrices with a very, very simple type. Look, you have here matrix, this one, the proportional to the inverse, and here you have zeros. Yeah, so this is an example of this maximal torus. And the, so we'll come back to this example. And now let me pass to the second part of this lecture, which is a fragment of our book with Professor Manin. So let me open this file. It is available also. By the way, I could give you some reference to many other files where you could get not only our book, the whole, but also some other books, which is the following. If you go to my web page, to the Perso, you find it in Google. If you type in Google my name, Panchishkin, then you have to my personal page, and then it is hidden. It is not openly written, but you can type after slash yourself, ETE, then lambda, lambda, and 2018-AP, like Alexei Panchishkin. And if you like just these lectures, there is also such a possibility. You can type 2018 Zetas, yeah, Zetas, Zetas, -AP. This is just PDF file of which you can print out as a without repetitions. This is a, how to say, which I transmit. All these files are available in the site, yeah, or Jean-Louis told me. So let me pass now to this fragment of our book, which is you can get also the totality, in particular this also part. So let me now again. Yeah, sorry. Over here. Ah, here, yeah. Plein écran, okay. Very good. So let us study the link between the classical modular forms and representation theory. This link is based on the fact that classical modular forms are functions on the upper half plane, yeah? And this upper half plane you can realize as a homogeneous space of the group, GL2, for example. You have the action of GL2 plus of the positive discriminant. But if you have negative discriminant, you need to take the opposite element. And you can realize it as a symmetric, is a homogeneous space of GL2 of R modulo the orthogonal maximal compact subgroup and the center also. Center is denoted here by center. And then you can pass from the functions on the group, from the functions on the upper half plane, you can lift it to the functions on the group. So this is a basic idea which is due to Klein. So he used it to forget upper half plane and pass to the group. Because then it makes it much more general. So here you have a modular form classically written as a Fourier expansion. Here e to the z is a exponential e to the 2 pi I z. And you define a function on the GL2 by the following formula. It is a f of g of I, which is in the upper half plane, times the automorphic factor, which is j of g of I, which is ci plus d. It is written here. If the determinant is positive. But if the determinant is negative, then you apply it to g of minus I, and you obtain element on the upper half plane, which you can then evaluate. And then you obtain this function, which is well defined on the upper half plane. And we denote the elements of this matrix A, B, C, D. So, and what is interesting that the automorphic property of such function, which we'll discuss more, expresses in a very simple way on the group. On the group, it just means that multiplication by the matrix of rotation acts as a multiplication by the exponential. It's equivalent to the automorphic property in this case. And then also the field of reals is not sufficient for this. So we need also a field of adels, ring of adels. Ring of adels, I recall you that this is a restricted product of R times a product of QP of periodic completions, and the restricted product means that these are all vectors, alpha infinity, alpha 2, alpha 3, and so on, such that alpha p is a periodic integer for almost all that p. So this ring has a natural topology of restricted product, which is also locally compact. This is a very popular object. And when what one can do, what one is the most popular is done, is to take the algebraic group over Q, for example, and to take its adelic points. That means values it not over the reals, but over the edels. And this gives you the object, which is also a locally compact group, which is basically used in the modern representation theory. So this is a modern tool. And why? Because you see, if you have such a form, modular form, so the basic property of this form is that one can use a basis of multiplicative functions. Of multiplicative functions. And the property that coefficients are multiplicative then transforms to a very simple property of representation. Then the representation is irreducible and develops over the product of over all points, real and all periodic points. That link was described also very well in many Carvalis lectures, especially of Pitetsky Shapiro. He wrote very simple text, but you can read it yourself. But the Carvalis proceedings I don't have on my side. Maybe somebody has, I could be. Do you have? No. Maybe some other person. It is in the library available, yeah. Carvalis proceedings. We translated it into Russian with Borovoy. You see, Borovoy is my colleague, so we translated in the Mir editors to the in 81. And now what you can do, you can take the components of this representation. So the idea is the following. You started with F, then you pass to F tilde, and F tilde gives you some representations of the adelic group, J of A. And then for every P, you have the representation of G of QP, of another group. G is here, is GL2 of Q, yeah? And if you do this, then you can describe such representations, as was noticed by Langlands. It's much easier to describe representations of a local field, over QP or over R. And over QP, the description of principal series, the most general, is the following. You take the torus in GL2 and the product of two characters, which are homomorphisms from QP star to C star, and the product of such characters give you one-dimensional representation of the maximal torus. And then from this representation, you can induce it to the, parabolic subgroup, to the Borel subgroup. And it gives you basically most of the representation, such construction. So this is the idea. So such a representation for almost all P are characterized just by these values of two characters, mu1 and mu2, which give you also mu1 of P and mu2 of P. These are complex numbers, because these are characters with values in CP, C star, pardon, in C star. And then when you got this matrix, which is a diagonal, you can form this data, as I told in the beginning of my lecture, as an Euler product. However, you have to exclude here some finite number of primes for which this representation is not of this type. Yeah? But for the others, you can do this. It will be much more, in much more details will be discussed by Siegfried. I'd like also to mention you one thing which is related to the next line of this. It's a relation to motives, but because motives are also in the title of our conference, yeah? So what is the relation between the representation data and motivic data? Talk relation to motives. The motives I will discuss also in very detail later on as a chapter also of our book with Professor Manin. But the L functions, they come as follows. So M is a motive over K. So the category of motives is obtained from the category of algebraic varieties by making some categorical operation. But we do not need this. We will use only motives as a collection of vector spaces. So our approach will be very naive. So this is a collection of Galois representations for all completions and just vector spaces over R and over C mostly. And the L function, so for each lambda place, so here lambda is not the root, but a place in K, so it's a, you can form a completion, K lambda. And you take also M lambda, a tensor, vector space over K lambda. This vector space is called realization of a motive. So it is not related, it is not a vector space here, but M lambda is a vector space. So we forget this complicated object and take a simpler object, M lambda. So M lambda is also endowed with the action of the Galois group, G of K bar over K. So which I also, the only thing we'll need is the following, that the all Frobenius element. Yeah, I tell you, K lambda is a completion of K in place lambda, which is a non-Archimedean. So it's a finite place, yeah? But what we need, the following property, thank you so much. For all primes P in K, the outside of the graph of P not in the finite set S, we have the characteristic polynomial. The size of this matrix is ID minus X of the Frobenius. The Frobenius element is defined of the Galois representation is P. So Frobenius P. Frobenius acts only in the case when it is not unramified. In the unramified one defines the Frobenius L. And what we claim, what we ask from this, because this matrix has a p-adic coefficient, lambda-adic coefficients. But it often happens that characteristic polynomial has a coefficient in a number field. So what we'll need that this polynomial belongs to the ring E of T, where E is a subfield of Q bar, which is called reflex field, or sometimes it is a coefficient field of the motif. So you see, we have, instead of complicated data, which is a category of varieties and so on, you have just collection of vector spaces, M lambda, with the Galois structure. This is also a difficult thing, of course. But also the collection of characteristic polynomials, which all belong to the, have coefficients in E, where E is some fixed number field. So E is a of finite degree over Q. And then whenever we have such a data, we can now do the same thing. We form the L function. The L function here, what is important, then this polynomial is independent of lambda. Frobenius P acts on M lambda, but independent of lambda. Independent on lambda. So it's the same for all P rational completion. So we have the matrices are all different, but polynomial is the same. Yeah. And now we take L function of a motif, L M S. This is the product of all P outside the finite number of this polynomial, which I call FP of X. FP of norm of P to the minus S to the minus 1. Yeah, so this is a definition of the motivical function. So it is thanks to the claim of the independence on the lambda, it is well defined. Yeah, it is this claim is true for the parts of algebraic variety. That's a part of the Delin's proof of the Weyl conjectures, because they are obtained by counting points, so they are mostly rational numbers or integers. In any case, this independence on lambda is very important. But I will discuss it more later on. So you have here, so two data. One data is we obtained from the representation theory L S, L pi S, yeah? This function, which is called sometimes also Jacquier-Langlands L function, pi here is not just one representation, but some data, including that will be described. But it has a nice property of the symmetry, S to the 1 minus S symmetry. And what concerns the motivic data, it has also the property of S goes to W plus 1 minus S, where W is a motivic weight. Motivic weight. And it is very tempting to compare these two definitions. One is comes from the representation theory, and another comes from the, how to say, motivic construction, yeah, which is from algebraic varieties. Like, for example, the theorem of Fermat-Weyl's. This is a part of this correspondence. And you have elliptic curve and the modular form of weight 2. So this is, how to say, hint for many future developments. But as you notice, the functional equation is not of the same type. Here it's S to 1 minus S, and here it is S to the W plus 1 minus S. So the relation which we claim now, it is written in the blackboard. It's a, how to say, where it is, disappeared, sorry. Yeah, here. So L pi S equals to L m s plus w over 2. So if you make such a change of variable, then the functional equation of the type s to the 1 minus s becomes the functional equation of the type w plus 1, because adding w over 2 shift you the functional equation by 2 times w over 2, so by w, so to say. So this is very simple link. But notice that when you have a modular form of weight k, this is not the same weight. The weight of a modular form w is k minus 1. This is a motivic weight. So please, this explains you also the factor in the Peterson Ramanujan Peterson conjecture, which is related to the motivic weight of this cohomology group, which was constructed by Deligne. And he proved by purity theorem that the all, how to say, absolute values are equal to the p to the power k minus 1 over 2. Because k minus 1 over 2, this is exactly motivic weight over 2. This in the group of w-dimensional cohomology on some variety. But, excuse me, maybe when do I stop? Yeah, so let me do some other words for, in order to start anew next time. So I would like to tell you that most classical objects in modular forms can be formulated representation theoretically. Here is a list. Look, the list is given here. So this is also, sorry, confused again. So you can have such objects as a real analytic wave modular forms of mass, then can be stated in representation theoretical terms. Hilbert modular forms, they correspond to the group GL2 over a totally real field. This is a second, the real, first, the classical elliptic modular form, that is a basis for real analytic Eisenstein series of this type. They also can be interpreted representation theoretically as some representations which are not, how to say, of moderate growth, but as a continuous spectrum of some of regular representation. So it is continuous spectrum. 6 automorphic forms on quaternion algebras and so on. That was considered by Maas and other people, but this is just the list, that there is some possibility to translate objects of classical modular forms to the representation theoretical objects. But I will not go into details. You can read it also from this file. And the Euler product that will be considered in Siegfried's lecture, the following form. You take not only the Sataki matrix, but also image of this under representation. But that I not go into detail, because there will be another lecture on this subject. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have some questions.